Good morning, everyone. I'm Doug Rice, the Performance Racing Network. We're the national radio group that covers all of the races at the Speedway Motorsports tracks. And of course, among those will be the upcoming Coca-Cola 600 here at Charlotte Motor Speedway. I'm coming to you from the studios of the Performance Racing Network. Every Memorial Day weekend, the world's attention turns to the events here at Charlotte Motor Speedway as we pay tribute to the men and women of the United States Armed Services with one of the largest pre-race events ever. Mission 600 is an extension of that effort, bringing together the Coca-Cola Racing family drivers and the military units of the United States Armed Services. And today we are going to be joined by the U.S. Coast Guard Station Fort Macon, and their sailors are going to give us a tour. Can't wait for that. And we're also going to be joined by Daniel Suarez, a member of the Coca-Cola Racing family, who is doing really well with his brand new team, Trackhouse Racing, this year. But before we meet Daniel and before we talk to the sailors, let's bring in the general manager of Charlotte Motor Speedway, Greg Walter.
Thanks, Doug. And thanks to everybody for making this happen today. There's a lot of stuff going on behind the scenes to make the magic happen. Daniel, always thank you for making time for us. And thank you to everyone down at Fort Macon. Personal note, I used to go to the beach growing up in Eastern North Carolina. I used to go to the beach at Atlantic Beach. And my dad, when my brother and I behaved, he would take us down to the gates at Fort Macon. And we would stare through the fence to see if the Coast Guard cutter was there, if we could get a glimpse. So as a grown up, many decades later, I'm actually really excited about this visit. The Coca-Cola 600 has become this amazing event that celebrates, you know, what our servicemen and women do every day to secure our liberties. But we also have this really wonderful focus on what Memorial Day really means. So Mission 600 kind of kicks that off for us. And so glad to have Daniel join us. So looking forward to the tour, and thanks for making it happen. Doug?
All right, thanks a lot, Greg. We will hear from Daniel Suarez here shortly, and maybe, just maybe sometime in the future, Greg, you can get down there to Fort Macon, and they'll actually give you a real tour as opposed to the virtual one we're having today. We are thrilled for the men and the women of the United States Coast Guard that are going to be with us today. It is my pleasure now to introduce the commanding officer of the Coast Guard cutter, Richard Snyder, stationed at Fort Macon, Greg Briderial. Greg, thank you for making time for us today. Lieutenant, the floor is all yours.
All right. Good morning. Thanks for coming down and being with us. We're honored to have you guys here. I, too, look forward to you guys hopefully coming down at a future date in person, and we'll show you the great ship here. So it's a beautiful day here in sunny Atlantic Beach. Three cutters are here. Three major Coast Guard ships are here. It's us, the Richard Snyder, our sister ship, the Nathan Bruckenthal, and actually the queen of the fleet, the oldest Coast Guard cutter, still operational, the Coast Guard cutter Smilax. But we were commissioned in 2018. We're a 154-foot fast response cutter with the 27th fast response cutter in use by the Coast Guard, and one of the newest assets that the Coast Guard has. Our primary missions are law enforcement and search and rescue. So primarily we go from Florida up to New England, and we do that fisheries enforcement, so making sure people are catching the right size fish, not overfishing, and doing the right things out at sea. And then we also do a lot of search and rescue. So if you're ever out offshore and you're having issues, we might be one of the ones that comes out to help you out. It's a beautiful day here. Couldn't have chosen a better day. It's about 70 degrees, and it's great, sunny here. We were named after the PM1 Richard T. Snyder, one of the Coast Guard's enlisted heroes. He was critical back in World War II. He was one of those Coast Guard heroes that got the actual Silver Star, and that's who we're named after. I'm going to turn it over to, with me here, we have BM2 Zach Weber and BM2 Courtney Swink. They're two of our bosun mates, so they drive the small boat, and they handle the lines. They take care of the ship here. They're going to walk you through the ship and answer any questions and hopefully talk to Daniel here. They're both real big NASCAR enthusiasts, and they're really excited to have you guys with us. But yeah, great. Thanks for coming down. Thanks for being with us on this Zoom call, and we're excited to be part of it.
Good morning, everybody. everybody. We want to thank you again for joining us. We have our Coast Guard Cutter small boat here. This is our 26-foot stern launch and stern recovery small boat. It brings our boarding team members over to the larger vessels or smaller vessels, primarily used for boarding team member transportation and immediate SAR response. Pretty much it. We'll go ahead and get these guys out of here, show you a little launch. Go ahead, guys.
Let's go.
And that is pretty much it. They are off to do a mission. We'll take you up to the bridge now. This is pretty much where everybody drives the boat from. Send it over to the BM2 back lever.
Hey, what's going on, everybody? BM2 over here. Get you on a little tour through our bridge. All right, so this is kind of where the command and control starts for daily operations. We have a little watch station. It's called a QMO. It's quartermaster of the watch to kind of keep up with the daily schedule, the watch quarter station bills, where everybody's supposed to be throughout the day to keep up with weather on various instruments. They also verify our position using GPS and make sure we're on the right track so that we don't essentially hit anything and cause hazard navigation. So over here, we'll have usually Captain sits here. He supervises, but throughout the day, different people are on watch. It's about like a four-hour rotation. Different monitoring systems up here. We have a full system to make sure that the boat is safe. Our alarm system, so if we have any type of casualty, we can see it from up here, take control, and then deal with that casualty in the right way. Really cool stuff. Brand new technology to the Coast Guard. We even have really cool instruments like this little remote here, drive the whole ship just from a little remote. Very fun. But this is where it happens. So if we get called out to a SAR case, this is main spot, main hub. Everybody's up here watching and making sure we can bring some people home safe. That's about it. We're gonna move forward and keep going with the tour. I'll pass you off here to GM2 Danielle Wilson. She'll kind of walk you through our gun system.
Hey, I'm GM2 Danielle Wilson. This is GM3 Hunter Stanfield. And this is our Mark 38 Mod 3 gun weapon system. It fires a 25 millimeter round from a remote location. The primary purpose of the weapon system is defense of the cutter from surface threats. With its highly sophisticated gun stabilization system, it is extremely accurate in all conditions, and it can fire up to 180 rounds per minute up to several miles. So now we're going to go ahead, we're going to go back into the bridge. We'll go down to the galley. Take it toward the inside of the ship.
Can we come back up?
Which is one of the
Then I got some rice over here. That's going to be cilantro lime rice. We're serving in about an hour, so everything's not like quite ready yet. I got some pico de gallo. So I'll make lot. Some queso fresco, and then this is like a onion and cilantro mix. There's a little bit of lime and salt. And then I'm gonna do like a Mexican sweet corn style. So I'm gonna saute this up with some mayo and then some tortilla cheese and then like some lime and some chili. And we're gonna have like some salsas and some chips and stuff. And start it for the meal.
How many people?
We see about 20 to 25. It's usually in 20. So meals a day. And then import, it's about one or two. We have workout periods from 9. So those days we don't have bread. And so thank you.
This is the crew mess deck area. This is where we're enjoying pork belly tacos for about 45 minutes. We'll bring you guys back up outside. We'll say goodbye to the crew. Thank you very much. And that will be it.
All right, once again, thank you for stopping by. We appreciate y'all with the support and everything. It was a pleasure giving a tour, but have a great Coast Guard day. Daniel, good luck on your next race. We'll see ya.
Thank you very much, my friend.
All right, well, that was fantastic. We will have our crew members hang out there for a little bit, and they're going to have a chance to ask Daniel Suarez some questions and chat here in a little bit. I was really impressed with the bridge there. It didn't look anything like what I thought it would be. It looked more like the bridge of the Starship Enterprise, especially finding out that they run the cutter with a handheld remote. That was quite impressive. Daniel, I know we didn't get down into the engine room. They have a very powerful one. And I think that you've got a little video presentation to talk a little bit about the simulators that you use to get ready to go racing.
Yeah, of course. I have one simulator at home that...
Hello, amigos. How are you guys doing? Come in. I will show you my new simulator. Come this way. My amigos at Trackhouse Racing got this simulator for me. Good thing I'm good with wrenches because it took me a day to put it together. Nice seat, nice steering wheel, it's super important. Nice pedals. Very comfortable, but you know, something that that is very important is to have also a nice internet, because sometimes the cars, they have some lag, and you can't really race comfortable when you are having those issues. Lucky for me, I have my amigos at Comscope that they hooked me up with a brand new system here in my house with almost 500 megabytes of speed, and we're ready to race today. Oh, he's the boss. What's up, buddy?
Hey, how's it going, man?
Good, man. You?
Good.
Do you see the simulator right here?
Yeah, show that thing, man. Right in the kitchen.
Right in the kitchen, man. We have to get rid of the kitchen table.
That thing really ties the room together, man.
It looks nice, eh?
Yes, it does look nice. Yeah. It's a cool race on the Irish kitchen.
On dirt, Bristol.
That'll be good, because you don't have much experience on that route.
But no, I'm four wheelers, I'm motorcycles, but I don't think that counts.
All right, man, we'll go get some practice. That big first race, the debut. We'll get those laps in, man. I'll see you after.
Okay, amigos, now it's time for you guys to go. Tonight, we're racing Bristol on dirt. I'm a rookie. I have to practice as much as possible along with my squad. So let's go.
Come here. Well, thanks for the tour there. That was awesome. Daniel, we appreciate your time today. A couple of quick questions here. Just how important is simulation for performance now, especially since for the last year or so, there's been no practice time?
Yeah, I mean, simulation, you know, with my engineers and trying to test as much adjustments as possible is very important. But it's one of those things that if you use it right, you can use it to your advantage. But if you don't use it right, it can actually hurt you. And we've been in both sides of the coin this year. Early in the year, we're still trying to figure out a few things. And actually we went to a racetrack and it was completely different. So it guided us in the wrong direction. But once you start to figure out what you need, how different it is to real life, then it's actually a very, very useful tool for the engineers and for myself. There is all kinds of different simulators and obviously the ones that we have, you know, at RCR and as well as Chevrolet are very sophisticated and we can bring the engineers and they can make changes and make it like the real race car. The one I have at the house, obviously, you know, is more for fun. That's not something that actually relates to the real racetrack, but it's still something fun and it helps you to be disciplined, to hit your marks, to be consistent, stuff like that. But when it comes to a real race car, it's a different kind of simulator.
As you prepare mentally through the season with the simulator, talk a little bit about your physical condition, because when you race here in Charlotte in about a month in the Coca-Cola 600, you're in the car at speed for almost 4 hours. So talk a little bit about your physical prep.
Yeah, it is a long race. Physical is something that I personally, I don't take lightly. You know, I think physical is extremely important, not just for your body, but as well for your brain, mental. And I think that as we get into the summer races, all that part, it just gets even more important, you know. There is some drivers that take more serious than others. I think is the winner of the race always is decided in the last lap, and it's very, very important to be strong physical and mentally, not just in the beginning of the race when everyone is fresh, but at the end of the races, that's when you win those races. So, you know, I try to stay in shape as much as possible. And I think that's something that is extremely important that many, many people forget is the kind of fuel that you put in your system. And when I'm saying that, I'm talking about the food. You know, you have to eat well and you have to eat healthy, and because, you know, you're gonna be whatever you eat through the week and through the weekend. So I think that's something extremely important.
Let's talk a little bit about your team. You're with a new organization. You guys started from the ground up this year, Trackhouse Racing, and you've, I think, have surprised a lot of people with the performance level. I know you were briefly in that video, you referenced the Bristol Dirt Race. You went up there, you led a lot of laps on your first competitive time on dirt and had a top five finish. So talk a little bit about this new organization, about your boss that was also shown in that video.
Yeah, I think we have been doing a good job. I think that our potential is higher, to be very honest with you. I think that we still have a few areas to improve, but this team is going to win races. I have no doubt about that. And I'm hungry to be able to get there. I'm trying to be patient, but we're going to get there. I know that the group of people that we have, you know, not just in the race team, but in the ownership with Justin, Ty, and Pitbull, it just feels so good. We have such an amazing group of people that I think is going to make us very successful on the racetrack.
Justin, a lot of people don't know him. He's an interesting character, isn't he? Your boss. He does a lot.
He's a very smart guy, you know, and I like the fact that he's still a race car driver, you know, he's still racing and he understands the business part of racing extremely well. You know, it's very good to have a person that understands the ins and outs. And obviously he's very young, so he still have a long career, you know, as an owner in the sport. So just very, very happy to have the journey with him in the early phases of track house racing.
All right, I'm looking at you on screen now, and you're surrounded by all kinds of trophies and awards. Where are you as you're speaking with us today?
In my house.
Okay. So what's the big trophy over your left shoulder there?
Is the championship trophy from 2016. Probably the best trophy I have, the more meaningful. You know, the first time, you know, winning a championship here in the United States, it was definitely special.
And that was a, well, and you're looking to replicate that on the Cup side, I know. Talk about the race that just happened before we go back to chat about the Coke 600 a little bit at Talladega. It seemed like it wasn't quite as frantic for part of the race as we usually see there.
Yeah, it wasn't as crazy as we normally see in super speedways. You know, we had a different strategy than most of the other cars, and to be smart and be there at the end, which we did exactly that. We put ourselves in position to actually win the race by the end. Unfortunately, you know, I had a 24 behind me. I had a 43 behind me, a very, very good line of Chevys to make a good run for their money to the Fords. But the 24 had a little bit of damage, and then I had a little bit of damage in my rear bumper as well. And when he pushed me hard in chain reaction with the 43, he just, my rear bumper and his front bumper just didn't take it. And I almost wrecked the field there. I felt like the entire field only won by not wrecking everyone, because it was a very close call. But you know, it's what it is. I feel like we put ourselves in position, and that's all we can ask for. We were there when it counts, coming to the white flag. So we have to keep working hard. I feel like more opportunities like that we're going to have this year.
I'd love to see that. I think we are set up now with our video crew on the Richard Snyder there to take some questions from some of the sailors. You ready to do that?
Of course, yeah.
All right, so just to introduce yourself and fire away your questions here for Daniel Suarez. Go ahead.
Good morning.
DM
Courtney Swink again. Daniel, thank you again for joining us. I just had a question about your Bristol race. So you going into your Bristol race only being on dirt twice, or that was your second time on a dirt track. What were your thoughts going into that?
Well, first of all, thank you for giving me the tour. It was amazing. I have a few questions for you as well after I answer yours. I grew up and I was born in Mexico. So we don't have dirt tracks for race cars over there, at least where I grew up. And, you know, I have had that little thing inside of me of trying dirt at least once to see how it is, and now I had to do it because we're heading with the Cup Series to dirt. You know, the Tuesday before the race, it was my first time on dirt, and I knew if I could understand the way it works, I knew I was gonna be able to be fast. I feel like every race car driver in the Cup Series is very talented to drive cars. We just need to understand how things work, and I feel that's the part that takes the most time, you know, understand pretty much the concept to go fast, you know, what it takes to go fast on dirt, what it takes to go fast in asphalt and stuff like that. So, you know, I think I got that kind of figured out. I got a lot of people helping me to be better, and then we went to Bristol, and honestly it was quite different than everything that I was expecting. It was, on my opinion, it was kind of like dirt racing, and then slowly was making a transition into half and half, because the dirt was getting so much rubber that it wasn't asphalt, it wasn't concrete, but it wasn't dirt either. So it was very, very difficult. But if you were getting out of the group, it was completely dirt. So it was a combination. So that's why I think that, you know, any driver that adapt the quickest was fast. So, you know, and obviously I had a fast car too. So, you know, it was a combination of things that really helped me to be competitive and have fun. I think that was my main thing, to have the mentality of learning a lot and have fun. It's been a while since I have jumped on a race car without knowing what to expect. And I just wanted to learn and I wanted to have fun, and things worked out well.
You did a really good job. Congrats again on your top 5 finish there.
Thank you.
Hey, what's going on, Daniel? This is BM2 Weber. Once again, thank you for stopping by. It was awesome to give a tour. I definitely had a question. I'm curious, before a race, your night before, getting your mindset right, do you have any rituals? Do you have something that you have to do every time before a race? Play video games, anything like that?
You know, I think that, thank you. Thank you for you, for the tour. It was amazing. You know, I have always loved the ocean, and I have a lot of respect for everything that you guys do. I hope one day I can take a few weekends off and I can take a trip to you guys say New England? You guys go all the way to New England?
We do sometimes, absolutely.
That's very cool, man. That's amazing. So anyway, you know, I'm big into having a good rest and a good fuel in your system. You know, I have to eat well to be able to perform well. I have always thought that if you put better fuel into your car, it's going to run faster. So I think it's the same way to our bodies with food. So I try to eat extremely well the night of the before the race, and as well to eat extremely well. So right before the race, you know, the day before the race, I have already my routine of food. You know, how many hours before I have to have breakfast, how many hours before I have to have lunch. And then there is 1 hour before the race that I just lay in bed, just trying to clean my mind, trying to relax, trying to enjoy the moment, because sometimes it's hard to remember how every single driver got into racing. I don't think there is one driver out there that got into racing because they wanted to be on TV, or because they wanted to make money, or because they wanted to be, you know, taking care of sponsors. The reason why we got into racing is because we love to race, and that's it. And sometimes it's very easy when you get in a high level to forget that. You know, you have so many responsibilities, so many meetings, so many sponsors that you have to take care of, interviews and meet and greets and stuff like that, that it's very easy to forget that we got into racing because we love racing. So I think that it's very important to reset our mind of everything that is going on outside the race car and get into that zone and go out there to have fun. Because, you know, that's the most important part, you know, to enjoy driving race cars. And I really, you know, that's what I do before the race.
Absolutely. Thank you so much. I mean, that's pretty much what we do here. It's definitely a fun job. We get to work with so many different people all the time and create a team. It's very relatable on that note. And, you know, we look out for each other, and having fun is like the main goal.
The friendships and relationships that we get from this job is absolutely amazing.
That's amazing. Thank you. Thank you for everything you guys do. I have a question. So right in the front, you guys have like a huge gun, right?
We do.
So, two questions there. One, when you guys have to use that? And two, can you guys operate that from the cabin, or somebody has to actually go there and operate it?
So that gun is electronically operated or manually. We do have the option. If it's electronically, it happens inside on the bridge. There's a little computer that basically tells the gun everything what to do.
That's super nice. I would be scared to be in front of that thing.
I think everybody is.
Yeah.
In the event we would have to use that, would be definitely like a self-defense, protecting our ship or protecting somebody else. That's pretty much the only reason.
So it's common to see people on the ocean, like bad people on the ocean doing wrong stuff?
There could be. I mean, you never know what you're going to kind of get into. Hopefully we get some information before just, you know, kind of sailing up on somebody like that. But we definitely do our due diligence on that vessel and making sure we're not going to be caught off guard.
That's good. That's great, guys. Well, thank you very much, guys, for the tour. It's amazing. Hopefully next time we can do it in person, because I love everything related that you guys do, with the boat, with the ocean and all that kind of stuff. I'm very, very interested in all that kind of stuff. So hopefully next time we can do it in person, and hopefully as well, you know, when things get a little bit better, we can meet at the racetrack.
You're more than welcome anytime.
I have a quick question for our bosun mates. If you can share this, can you give us a quick anecdote or story about one of the more dramatic events, like a rescue or something that you guys have personally been involved in?
Well, our crew in the past couple of months, we've responded to various vessels that either they lost power out, bad storm, pretty much losing propulsion. You're stuck out there. You need help. I know our crew responded, I think, within a good 4 hours. They were really far away, 100 miles. I mean, got there super fast. Our boat was capable of, you know, high speed. Got there, got everybody on board safe. Everybody was okay. And then we towed that vessel back. They had a little bit of damage, but almost no boats are very cheap. So that's, I guess, the most recent one.
Well, that's wonderful. Thanks for sharing that story. Daniel, if you ever get out on the ocean, these are the right people to have in your neighborhood.
Let me tell you, if you ever go in the ocean that far, going all the way to Europe, I want these guys going with me. I don't think I would take you or anyone else.
All right. We appreciate the men and the women of the Coast Guard cutter Richard Snyder being with us today. The tour was fantastic. Daniel, thank you for your time. I'm going to kick it back to Charlotte Motor Speedway General Manager Greg Walter to wrap up.
Listen, thanks to all of you at Fort Macon. That was pretty incredible. And given the limitations, that's probably the best Zoom call I have ever been on. So we really appreciate that. One last question for you. How quickly can you go from being docked to on the water out to rescue somebody?
We actually just had a search and rescue call, and I believe the recall time for all crew members from the minute they got the phone call till the minute all lines were off the pier was about 2 hours, 30 minutes, and that was 3 o'clock in the morning.
Wow. Y'all are truly amazing. We can't wait to get back on the road and visit with people like you. And then also, you know, the Coca-Cola 600 bringing to light all that our service men and women do. So thanks for making this an extraordinary day. And Daniel, thank you for making the time, and good luck this weekend and for the Coca-Cola 600.
Thank you very much, Greg. Thank you very much, everyone over there. And like Greg say, hopefully we can see you guys in the racetrack very soon. And also, I need my rain check for later this year to go check out that boat in person.
Something tells me you won't have a problem getting a rain check. Daniel, I think we're supposed to ask you to do a shout out to all the men and the women of the armed services here as we wrap up our call. So I'm going to leave that up to you, whatever you want to say.
Yeah, of course. I just want to thank you guys because, you know, for someone like me, you know, coming from a different country, coming from Mexico and having all these amazing benefits that this country and thanks to you guys, we can, you know, enjoy, you know, our freedom or safety everywhere. So it feels amazing. Really, really. Thank you for everything that you guys do. It really means a lot for me to be partnered with people and with companies like NASCAR and already like Coca-Cola. They support the men and women like you a lot. Hopefully, like I said, next time we can we can meet in person.
Very well said, Daniel. Special thanks today to the men and the women of the Coast Guard Cutter, Richard Snyder. We appreciate them joining us. It's nice that Mother Nature cooperated and gave us a beautiful day there at Fort Macon. We're looking forward to the Coca-Cola 600 here at Charlotte Motor Speedway Memorial Day weekend. We're going to have a nice crowd, not the big monstrous crowds that we had. And we also look forward to the wonderful pre-race show that recognizes all the men and women of the armed services. On behalf of Charlotte Motor Speedway, the Coca-Cola Racing family, and the Coast Guard, thanks for everybody for being with us today.
Thank you.
Thank you.